shared information along those lines. If you would please turn your tab to Roads and Bridges. You will start with the engineering definitions and acronyms and then the criteria for paving and the steps for paving. So, Mike, do you have any comments you'd like to make, Commissioner?
A lot of things that you hear the engineering department, the public works department talk about, we're talking acronyms from the DOT. You got NASHTO, FHW, NGDOT, MBS, MBO, MUTCD, MBDS, SAP, and UBC. Those are the acronyms that we talk in, so what we want to do is to give you a little background of what some of those were, we said that we're going to be doing some research and that there will be, that you understand that there will be our local maintenance and
questions on those acronyms and so forth.
rain 3 inches today, and you can drive tomorrow, you don't have an issue. But there's some of them, if it rains a quarter of an inch, you're going to slip slide away. And so what does it take for Robin to maintain it? If it's one of these that we're constantly after having to buy, then those are ones that we would like to get back. Does it serve as a connect between two paved roads? good road, you know, south end of Blue Lake Road, you can have a lot over to 41, but then north end Clydesdale, those are good roads that are good connector and staggered routes. Those are good connector roads that would get a lot more traffic use if they were paved. Anticipated growth areas, what is it, only in the area? And do we have water and sewer near? If there's water and sewer there and the road gets paved, somebody's going to dump it. And then, what's it going to cost? Some of the small dirt roads that you would think would cost a whole lot, will cost a whole lot just because of the drainage features that will happen. One of the costliest roads that we built was Old Mayor Road, just because Old Mayor Road didn't, the dirt out there was horrible. Everything had to be dug out and new dirt brought back in. So those are things that we try to look at.
The Department of Transportation also has criteria that are, in many cases, identical to these for their determination, participation in paving projects. Obviously, that participation over the years less than almost every year. But for your information, as you get requests from the citizens, these are the criteria that we use to evaluate that road and recommendations that we would make as staff. Fine, measurable list here that we would go by. It's not just off the top of our heads. It's whether it's a good project or
not. So, I'm going to ask you this question. You came up with criteria and everything. I don't know what the catch-all phrase we're talking about, the real safety, the issue of public safety. Did we put that in the bus? Is that just
that's
catch-all?
That's not the catch-all. And then the next is the steps for paving that road, not just a matter of, okay, you turn in your petition and it's met these criteria, you start tomorrow.
Several years back when Chairman Stalling came on board, we wanted to kind of narrow down what we would do in some of the problems. So we developed a county petition that's got some criteria. And what we have given to people is this petition. I think everybody's got a copy of that for showing that 80%, in order for the county to start evaluating and start moving forward with it, 80% of the people need to sign the petition stating that they're willing to donate the right of way. So you get the petition. And then we bring it before the commissioners, and the road basically gets quote unquote approved to be put on the list. And you'll see the one of your pages is the big project list. Then what we do is we start looking at funding. Most of it is through SPLOST. And then whenever the road kind of works itself to the top or to the surface, we start looking at surveying and engineering, and then we obtain the right-of-way if we need to, and then we will let the project and then go to construction. Typically, from the time that you get a petition in, if all things work great, you're a year and 18 months before you can actually go to construction if the money was available.
that's assuming you don't have any people out there that give you trouble with right of way or things like that. Everybody out there agrees that they want the road paved. Zipper Road came up a little over a year ago, and we're already down to one parcel being signed. And we just started that in August, and so we started that in August, and right now we've got one parcel that's needed to be signed. They've agreed to sign it. It's just in the selling process, and they're determining which one's actually going to sell it, so they can, which one of them is going to actually sign the right of way. Buyer or seller, so that's we should have that wrapped up very quickly.
Mike, you might want to mention to the commission, but we do have some new commissions this year, that we also have a very, very good process in place where we do in-house payment.
That's right.
Where Public Works may have a department that will handle some of the paving, and most of them, that paving generally is done, correct, in some of these older subdivisions that the dirt roads were built to standard,
right,
rather than just an old dirt bed. It was built to a certain standard, which gives us a little bit better foundation to work with. So you might want to just kind of share that.
If you look on the project list, there's the second column over, you'll see where it says in-house or paper. If it shows paving, that's something that we will let out to contractors for paving. But if it's in-house, like the chairman said, these are typically the older dirt road subdivisions that the ditches are already in place, a lot of the drainage is already in place, that we can go in and firm up the ditches a little bit, get the road bed on the good grade, and bring in the base and pave it. We did the one out at off of Glen Grove subdivision. That's a good example. Very little cost that we had out there, and paved almost 2 miles of road out there in the subdivision.
And it looks good.
And it looks good. And I mean, and there were 60 some odd parcels on that road, 60 houses on those five roads that we made, made happen. That they're not driving in the mud. And but that's the ones that you see that have in-house buying are roads that we already have right away on that are real easy, and lack of better terms, the low-hanging fruit that we can go out and do easy.
And really, kind of like you said, in most cases, you'll touch more property owners in those subdivisions than sometimes I'm doing some of the other roads.
Yes.
So again, like I said, that's the low-hanging fruit that we can go out and get them and get it economically or cheaper because of the efficiency that Public Works and that particular department that are paving crew is able to do.
And I think, Robin, you got, not counting truck drivers, we got about six or eight folks on that crew. They're all very proficient. They know what they're doing, shooting grade, running excavators, running pans, running the bulldozer, motor grader, whatever they need to do, they can run those pieces of equipment and build a road just as good as anybody else. It takes us a little bit longer, granted, because sometimes we have to pull off and go do other things. We don't have 20 guys, like if Marine showed up out there, he's showing up with 20 guys, or three different crews to lay pipe and one crew building up. We got one crew, but if you look at all those projects, there's about 88 miles of total road on there that we're looking at paving. 15 of it we can pave with our guys, you knock almost a quarter of the, or 20% of the roads off of there with just our in-house guys.
We just talked about the paving line. We talked about doing the site prep.
That's right.
And the contractor then comes in.
And runs an asphalt.
We don't have that equipment, but I didn't tell you.
Mike, there's so many variables that go into this. I mean, it's hard to just say. I mean, I look at this and I go, column for when the petition was received. And then I think, you know, well, it should be in some type of priority or chronological order. How do you know? Is it just based on where we're at, where the SPOS dollars are? I mean, it's got to be overwhelming how to figure out exactly how to keep this in
place. It is, and a lot of it is on need. The roads we're going to do this year are Boyd Pond Base Road. We're going to finish that one because we've got all the right over there. The Coppedge Road from east of Allendale, we have finally got that one wrapped up. We've got to do Morgan Road Bridge. That's going to be on your agenda. That bridge is in very bad shape. I believe that it is just rated for 14 tons, so 28,000 pounds. That's one of the oldest bridges in the county. The actual oldest bridge in the county, well, it's two more. The oldest bridge in the county is upper equipment. But then the next bridge we'll do next year is the one over Bevel Creek. We're trying to get the higher traffic roads, bridges first, but Bevel Creek will be next year. But after we get this one taken care of and get Bevel Creek taken care of, all of our wood pile bridges will pretty much be non-existent. And
to answer your question, that this is not just a list that we've recently put together. This is a culmination of years and years and years and years of requests being made, and then the county commissioners assessing those over the years and establishing priorities.
Well, and
keeping in mind also that in a perfect world, if you had all the money that you needed to pay this to do this work, then you could get it completed. We don't have that kind of money. You know, even over the 6 year SPOS period where a ton of this is at, we don't have the kind of money that is going to take complete the priority of this. So again, as far as the need goes, as far as the money as it comes in, and how we can get the project requirements from the standpoint of right of ways and engineering all done, that kind of begins to set the priority as far as how to do it.
And I understand that. I'm just saying, how do I make sure? I mean, I see like Arapaho Trail and Bent Creek Circle, for instance. Those are two that I've kind of taken some interest in. I've had calls about, you know, they claim they've been on the list for a while. You know, how do we know? How do I know what to tell those people as far as short of some major emergency? You know, look, we're working our way down on this in-house paving list, because it's my understanding with both of those, they're in-house, the right-of-way is done, everything. How do I know how to respond to the questions of when?
If we didn't have any issues where Robin had to quit, pull people off to go do other things, we could finish that 15 miles of in-house paving in about 5 years. We could have all of those roads done. How we're looking at those in order, we're trying to look at where they are as far as maintenance, where they are as how many car or houses are on there, how much traffic's on there, and we're just trying to and trying to spread it out north end, south end, east, west. We're trying to, you know, not stay all in the side for all in the north. I'm just trying to spread them around.
That's what I said. I know there's so many variables that play into all that.
But to answer your question about the first two, those are probably the next couple of years. This year, they're going to, the in-house crew is going to be Bill Frey, Chairman and Commissioner Powell met with us up there at Hill Road. We've already got the utility. One utility was all that needed to be done. We've got that one relocated. So we're going to do Hill Road this year. And there's 30 houses.
Is that both sides?
No, just the west side. Just the west side of Hill Road. We're going to do that one this year. And then if we when we get through with that one, We're going to start on Terrace Wood, which is out in District 1. That's a so long, what I say long, about a little over half a mile dirt road. It's real wide. All we got to do is go in there and shake up the ditches.
Say, there it is, that's the project, go and finish it. They have to do it.
in between night and brainchild.
And I said, if we could go out there and work 40 hours a week, we could knock out these 15 miles of road in the next 5 years. We could knock out about 3 miles a week. But there are shoulders that have to be cleared. There are dirt roads that have to be built up. There are crossroads that have to be cleared. And that's when we have to put them on.
We're modern, the commissioners having to deal with modern time, which is the balancing act that we're kind of facing, because at the end of the day, like I said, these roads came about 15, 20 years ago, something. But we're looking at what the growth is like now, some of the development is like now. And some of these same things have only gotten worse. Again, I looked at some of the bridges, they get worse.
So, you have 318 miles of dirt roads, and you basically have a priority list, let's call it that, of roughly 88 miles. There's still a lot of folks that live on dirt roads that wants to live on dirt roads.
And that's the other issue.
Yeah. So that's the reason I felt like it was extremely important that we come up with this criteria, that before we went out there and started plowing anything into it from the standpoint of design and engineering and right-of-way acquisition, those sort of things, we need to be sure that folks were willing to step up and we're going to be willing to give up those right-of-ways so that can evolve. Then you can put some money in it, you feel like it's an investment. So that's the reason why that was kind of
developed. And there are roads on this list that will never be paved.
Yeah.
I'm just being honest, because there's a couple of roads on here, they told us, go away. Mm-hmm. Don't come back, we don't want our road paved.
Why are they still on the list?
Because they were on a SPLOST list. This is a compilation of all of the SPLOST lists. So some commissioner at some point put them on the list.
I just wanted to make sure we had a priority list and that we were treating people fairly in how we approach this. Outside of emergency.
Property owners change some of the one time won't be paid. Somebody comes back and says, I've bought the property, I don't want to pay a bunch of company issues. And we still keep those there. It's because I had that request. And things may change, they may not. The new commission may come in at some point in time and say, you know, this is our commitment. And we're going to condemn whatever we have to condemn and pay whatever we have to pay. So, and they will say, well, we want to go off the road for what we got. It's a tool. It's for your use. To use with this car or anyway, generally. Mike, you comment briefly on those items related to paying up driveways and trucks and so forth.
Okay.
As to how that pertains to the paying process.
When we get into paving and driveway negotiations and things like that, the county has the right way to be donated. We're not actively paying for right-of-way to give it by right-of-way. If you have a driveway now and you get a driveway back, if you've got a parcel that doesn't have a driveway, we give you a driveway. Because we know that sometime in the future, you're going to need a driveway. There are people that have bigger parcels, maybe with timber, they only have one driveway. We offer them a second driveway because, it would benefit them when they do go in and harvest their timber to have a second driveway. Trees and shrubs, on Boring Pond Road, we gave the folks that live out there that have harvestable timber, we've given them notice that you can harvest your own timber. If you don't harvest it before you harvest it, you sell it. If you want to harvest it and sell it before we get there, great. That's that much less that we have to clear. But if it's there when we get there, we're going to cut it, and the contractor will either burn it or they'll sell it if there's enough to sell. But typically, the Lion Mills and the Sheltons and people like that, if there's enough there to make it work their while, they're going to cut it themselves. But the individual homeowner, if they have a
you know, a big shrub at the road, they will give them the option, you know, hey, you can pick it up, you can move it, or when we get there, we will take that excavator, we don't guarantee anything, but we'll pick it up and we'll set it back on the, off of the driveway. But it's yours. We're not digging a hole and we're not replanting. But those are, but we don't pay for trees, we don't pay for shrubs. One thing that we pay for is we have paid for trees that bear fruit, you know, like pecan trees and things like that. We pay for those because they are an income-based type tree, where they're income producing trees. The next one. Mailboxes, we move the mailboxes back for them, and if they want to put a new mailbox up, they go buy their mailbox and put it up for them. We do not replace brick mailboxes or masonry mailboxes. Wish they weren't even on our right-of-way, but there's nothing we can do to stop it right now, but we're not going to rebuild. Property pins and monuments during the right-of-way acquisition, each owner can specifically request those things to be put back in. We typically do not go repin property corners just because it's platted, it's at the courthouse, and whenever, just say it's the ASA, when they come through and they set the right-of-way for a new road, they're going to set the pin. Sometimes those pins get torn out during construction, sometimes they don't. If they get tore out, you know, we're not in the process of going back and resetting them. That's just too much money to have to do that. Fences, the DOT says that we will pay $4.50 a foot for fence. What we try to do is, you know, if you've got a nice wood fence or anything like that, we just give you $4.50 a foot. But if it's a farmer that's got a 5-4-string barbed wire fence, or he's got a hollow wire fence or anything else like that, we can do it cheaper than $4.50 a foot. So we're saving money by us putting up the fence, you know, just working it out. Hey, we're going to put you back your barbed wire fence, we're going to put you back your hollow wire fence, whatever. We can do it cheaper than $4.50 a foot, and they don't have to worry about it. So if it's, like I said, if it's a nice wood fence, we just pay the $4.50 a foot and we move on. That's the easiest thing to do. And utilities such as your water lines, wells, septic systems, things like that, we pay for those to be relocated. If you notice on new plats off of dirt roads, we reserve a right-of-way section on a dirt road, which is anywhere from 5 to 15, 20 feet, depending on how wide the road is now. And what we ask the people to do is in that reserved right-of-way, they're not giving us the right-of-way. They're not giving us anything. All they're doing is reserving it, and they're saying that we're not going to build a set tank and drain field or build our well inside that, to where if the county comes along and paves this road, we're going to have to move. So that's something we started about 18 years ago, and you know, everybody said, well, I'm not giving up my property. No, you're not giving up your property right now. You're not deeding to the county. It's just what you're telling us is that there's not going to be anything in our way when we do come here.
One of the things that I think is extremely useful to you as a commission is the SPLOST project list that you've already referred to. Next to the last column, I think, in the maintenance cost. From my standpoint, that's very important for the price. It costs us to continue to maintain the typical road versus the estimated cost of the same, just that term of that investment, make that cost effective. Again, it's a tool for after hearing what you heard yesterday from both Harrison and Stephanie, and also the comments related to potential changes in SPOS, I'm sorry, SPOS, sales tax, unavailable funds. I think that is a tool that I would urge you to continue to refer back to the major center for where these projects are going. Shouldn't you like to take a short break?
Yeah.
Let me ask something too.
Go ahead, Mark.
Are there any widening projects online anywhere? You know, county roads that need to be widened, so narrow.
We did go up and we widened Powell Road, most of you have heard of Powell Road recently. We added 2 foot of asphalt, and we put the rubber strips, on the edge. And, you know, I'm proud to say that project worked. That project has succeeded. I was very skeptical about it at first because I wondered, you know, how it was going to work out. But it has worked. And Robin and her guys have not had to go up there and fix shoulders. And it has worked.
When you do that, if you move the mailbox and put it back,
if we need to, yes. But what we other roads that we're looking at doing that same thing to in the future is Lockwall Road, because we've got a lot of drop-offs, shoulder drop-offs in there. Cat Creek Road, Skipper Bridge Road, those are roads that
Picture Grove Road.
It was on the list, but we moved it.
We've got
to know. That's the should have been.
But those are roads that we have looked at. There are two per se major widening projects that the county has got. That is, we're working through the MDO, and that's 41 and Lake Park Bellevue Road. As most of you know, Lake Park Bellevue Road Exit 2 is going to be upgraded. The bridge is going to be taken out and put a new bridge in there. Part of our project we're working through the DOT is to bring to widen Lake Park Bellevue Road all the way into the city of Lake Park, realign as it comes across the railroad tracks, and working with the DOT to put up a traffic signal at 376 Lake Park Bellevue 41. Because of all the truck traffic, there's a lot of accidents at that intersection because now you've got all the produce coming out of Eccles County. They're having to come out 376 to 41, turn right in, turn right left. A lot of accidents occur right there. And so the DOT is on board with that just as a safety process.
You're going to straighten that out?
Yes, sir.
Where you're going to have to turn right and then turn left?
Yes, sir. Lake Park Bellevue Road will turn to the left. We'll curve to the left and then come back and make a little S-curve and line up the 376 one in Eccles County.
That's a good question.
I know every road is different as far as pavement, but what is it, in-house pavement, what does it cost to do a mile of dirt road?
Typically if we hire a contractor, it's costing us about $500,000 a mile. If we're doing it in-house, we're doing it for about $300,000 a
mile. Well, thank you. We'll take a short break. We'll come right back. 10-minute break. Okay,
is that